Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. Merry Christmas. So glad to see you all here this morning. My name is Pastor Greg Ely. I have the privilege of serving as the campus pastor here at our South Kansas City campus. We are one church in two locations, so we also have an Overland Park campus as well. We have a few announcements this morning. First of all, next Sunday will be the day after Christmas, and at that point, we as a staff would have had five services on Christmas Eve, and it will be Christmas Day next Saturday. So next Sunday will be Christmas online. Yay! Yeah, but it'll be a fun opportunity. Go online, you'll see Pastor Jim delivering a message. When you leave out here today, there's packets in the lobby that help you enjoy your online service. So please grab one of those packets as you leave out today. You know, we have an amazing opportunity to worship with one of our sister churches, Palestine Missionary Baptist Church, here in Kansas City. Take a look at the video.
Pastor James Watkins, who pastors the only church in town with a longer name than ours, Palestine Missionary Baptist Church of Jesus Christ. That is a long name. So this wonderful church has invited us to join them for their annual watch service on New Year's Eve, December 31st, from 4 to 6 p.m. Now, we don't have a standing New Year's Eve tradition, but I've learned something, that their watch service goes all the way back to 1862, when there was the proclamation of emancipation, which created a lot of anticipation, but it didn't come into effect until midnight of 1863. Yeah. And so slaves and black worshipers and churches all over our country gathered together and counted down the seconds with joy and celebration, thanksgiving, that they would be set free when the clock struck midnight.
Yeah.
And so you guys continue to remember that and also to continue to have these watch services every year. How does it translate now? What does it mean for the congregation now in 2021 to have these watch services?
Good question, Jim. I know a lot of people have those questions, and maybe you do too. But for us, it continues spiritual. There's a spiritual component. We all need to be liberated and set free from our sins. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't matter if you're black, white, or Hispanic, or Chinese, whatever your nationality is, we all need to be set free in Christ. And so that is the gist of what we do and why we're doing it, to draw closer to the Lord and reflect on the past year. As you look over 2019, 2020, 2021, we haven't really had an opportunity to come together, but now we have an opportunity to come together. We would love for all these seats back here to be filled with people from different nationalities, different backgrounds, to not only reflect on the past years, but look forward to our new year in Christ as we grow closer to what God would have us to be.
Mm. I love this man's heart. Let me tell you something. This is a beautiful sanctuary. Seats 1,600, which is more than our largest sanctuary, by the way. A little bit envious. But even with the social distancing, they have it beautifully laid out. We can accommodate 800 souls here very safely. So we're encouraging people to come. Let's break down any walls of hostility that have existed throughout the ages and find our oneness in Christ as we count down the seconds to a new day, a new year, a new liberation in Christ. So it's going to be a wonderful time, about an hour of worship, then an hour of fellowship, and there will be food.
Yes.
And we don't even have to bring anything. I love it.
Come on.
Come on. So thank you for your willingness to just come and join us. It's going to be a fabulous night. I look forward to it, and we'll see you then.
God bless.
Amen. Hey, right? Amen. You know, this is a wonderful opportunity for us not to just, you know, spend an afternoon with another church. This is an opportunity for us to build a relationship. Myself, Pastor Mark, and our Bootstraps team have been working on this, you know, for years, actually. And this is our opportunity to step into that space, to show our city what it looks like to bridge that gap, to build relationships, and actually put our money where our mouth is, or our mouth where our money is. However it goes, show up. And that's Christmas Eve, and I believe there will be some carpooling, I think a bus may be available. You can call the church and ask, get more information about that. You can also park carpool together. New Year's Eve. That's because my next announcement is Christmas Eve. I went ahead. But yes, New Year's Eve, thank you. We'll be celebrating with Palestine. And so if you have any questions about that, you can call the church office. But we're looking forward to a wonderful New Year's Eve with our sister church. Amen. Speaking of Christmas Eve, next Friday, this coming Friday, actually, is our Christmas Eve services. We'll have a 3, 5, and 7 service at Overland Park and a 5 p.m. service here at SKC. So we're looking forward to you bringing out your family and worshiping together this coming Christmas Eve, 5 and 9 service here as well, okay? All right? And 5 and 9. Yes, Dave, 5 and 9. All right. And we want to thank you all for being such a generous church. I mean, I am in awe always of how generous this church is. And so we want to give you opportunity, especially at the end of the year, as the end of the year comes, you can give online, you can give through text, you can mail in your gift, or you can place your gift on the black, in the black box as you head out today. And we also want you to stay connected. In the pew in front of you, there's 3 cards. There's a connection card, a prayer card, and a serve card. You can fill any of those cards out and place them in the black box as well, and we will be in contact with you. All right, if there's nothing else, let us stand and worship together.
Good morning, let's join and sing together. Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strain.
Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong?
The Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit,
chosen our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious high. Forever seated.
Chapter 3, let's read the word of our Lord together. I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire.
Would everyone please be seated? People of God, let's pray. Father, it is with great joy that we celebrate today your coming into our world. Lord, according to your word, you come bringing good news of a new covenant between God and man. A covenant of love and grace. But your word also reminds us of our part in that covenant. Our need to be changed and refined by you, O God. For truly, which of us can stand on our own in the presence of a holy God? So, Lord, in this moment, we come to you with open hearts. Holy Spirit, reveal to us the things in our lives, oh God, that need to be changed right now, God. Hallelujah. And then hear us, oh God, and refine us, oh God, from the inside out. As we lift these things to you, oh God, and we ask, oh Lord, we ask. Hallelujah, we ask. For your forgiveness in Jesus' name.
God, we thank you for hearing us. And this season, we thank you for the promise of hope and salvation that you gave to us in the book of Luke and Matthew as Gabriel speaks to Mary and Joseph. And he says, you will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name of Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. God, we thank you. We thank you that you didn't leave us in our sin, but promised us a way back to you. And this morning, we celebrate the fulfillment of that promise as we lift our voices and remember a child born in a manger.
What child is this who
here I am to bow.
here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down. Here we are to say He is God. Not just God, He's our God. You know, I've been, like many of you, caught in traffic, pushing myself through lines, and stuck at cash registers, and almost being overwhelmed by the materialism that comes with this season. But I want you to just take a few moments to think about why we celebrate this season. Here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Here we are to say that You are. I want to ask our prayer team to begin to make their way to their positions of prayer. We'll have people down front to pray with you. We have people stationed in the back to pray with you. We'll have people in the balcony to pray with you. And if you feel led, maybe you just want to come and kneel at the altar and just bow down. We invite you to follow as the Spirit leads you. Maybe you're just inclined to stand where you are in reverence, however the Spirit is leading you. Here we are to worship. Somebody is grieving today because this season reminds you of a loved one who's no longer here. Let us pray with you. Someone is headed into this season with more questions than answers. Let us pray with you. Someone here is afraid of what 2022 is going to bring. Come, let us pray with you today. Here we are to worship. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus, we bless Your name today. We thank You, Father, we glorify Your God. We invite You into this space, Lord, this is Your house. Let us feel You today. Let us see You today, Father. Have Your way today, God. I also want you to take a few moments right now in the sanctuary today to take a moment to just ask God to forgive you, to repent of anything that may be interfering with you hearing God's voice, anything that may be causing trouble and anguish. If you don't know what to pray for, you can pray like the psalmist who says, "Search me, O God. See if there be any wicked way within me." Spend a few moments. There's nothing like a good season of repentance to free us from the bondage of sin. Father, forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. If anything, Lord, is in the way of me serving you, I'm ministering for you. Wash me, oh God. Father, we want to first of all, say thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we have made it this far in 2021. And we thank you, Father, that every day that we opened our eyes this year has been a day of purpose. That you would raise us in the morning on purpose, that you would order our steps that day on purpose. That you would engage in our conversations on purpose. That our lights have shined this year on purpose. We thank you, Father, that we're not beings that are floating through a system, but that we are on purpose. Designed, created to worship you. Father, we thank you that you know the number of the stars in the sky, yet you know my name. You know where I am. Then no one in here is lost. Father, I want to lift up our missionary of the week. Tracy Hoopman, who is serving during the holidays with our EPC World Outreach Team in North Macedonia. We pray, Father, for the Shift Center that serves and ministers to Albanian-speaking people in that region. We pray for spiritual protection and physical safety as she is traveling, even right now. We pray for excellent health and quality rest during her time in Macedonia. We pray, Father, that she does not get weary in her well-doing. And we pray, Father, that you allow her to see the fruit of her labor. We pray for those Albanian people who will hear the gospel, many for the first time, that you would let their light so shine, the Shift Center, that the people will see their good works and give you glory and run asking, "What must I do to be saved?" I want to lift up Jim Howard today, our South Kansas City prayer person. Father, I thank you for his heart. I thank you for his spirit. I thank you for his fortitude. I thank you for his desire to serve you in even in uncomfortable places. I thank you for his encouragement to us and our pastoral staff and our church. And I pray, Father, that he would be able to sense God's nudges and prompts and act accordingly for wisdom, for health, for safety and favor for his family. We pray for his 8 grandkids. His legacy. We pray for the Overland Park prayer persons of the week, Charles and Suzanne Ball. We pray that this couple, Lord, that you would let anything that would be caused to pull them apart be used to bind them together. We lift up our military persons of the week, which is our police officers and all law enforcement officers. Father, this is a hard occupation. And they've suffered a lot of turmoil this year. So I pray, Father, that as this year closes, that they would hear your voice telling them that you are not forgotten. That your service has not gone unnoticed. Father, let them know that you surround them and protect them. Speak to them and let them hear your voice louder than anything else. And Father, we close this time of prayer out today by praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, each month we have an opportunity to share our blessed stories, our blessed rhythms, which is the B, begin with prayer, L, listen and engage, E, my favorite, come on, eat. Gonna do a lot of that in these next couple of days. Serve your community, which provides an opportunity to tell, share your story. So today we want you to take a look at this video.
I'm Lennard. This is my wife, Becca, and our daughter, Harmony. And how we got started with Colonial was through Freedom Fire, which is where I work. That's how I became to know about Colonial. And then from there, my wife and I have checked out a couple Sunday services together. And then we got connected with the young adult group that meets on Tuesdays, and it was very real. The connections were very genuine. And so it was just, I think, a calling from Christ that this is a church that we needed to attend. And it was something that we felt good about with leaving Harmony in the children ministry while we were able to attend service and just be able to get a full understanding of what the pastors were talking about without having to worry about Harmony crying or screaming or having to deal with that.
They were just so nice, and they were so genuine, and they really wanted to know about us and our just every day, like we would talk about our highs and our lows for the week, and I just thought that was so wonderful. We would pray over each other.
And also just the importance of when you are a member of a church, how much your voice has a say. And I think that's also just another reason why we wanted to join Colonial. Just a growing population of young adults, but also that our voices could be heard, that our voices could be powerful. We were just able to see a lot more people just like us that was just looking for a church home, that was just wanting to be in connection with other believers, just wanting to be in fellowship with others, and just wanting that connection because of just coming off of this terrible, terrible virus. I'm not even being able to be in contact or communication face to face with people, and to see people just thriving or wanting to be in relationship, in communication, face to face.
It feels like a safe place, just having a group of people that I can be with and be honest with and be accepted for. We all come from different backgrounds and stuff, but we all come together in the core belief of Jesus is Lord, and we are here to spread the gospel to those around us.
Praise God. What a video. And our young adult group, which is growing, by the way, was wanting to do a serve project once a month, and so we were able to connect the young adult group with the Freedom Fire Ministries, of which Leonard helps lead. So we were all headed over to BB's Lawnside Barbecue, is where it all started. It always starts with barbecue and Jesus. But then, you know, we're so grateful to have Leonard and Becca and Harmony as part of our church family now. So praise God for that. Let's go ahead and open with a word of prayer. Let's pray. Lord God, I pray that you would bring the Holy Spirit's presence to penetrate our hearts and open up our minds and our ears to the message that you want us to hear today. God, preach to my heart as I preach to the hearts of your people. In Jesus' name, amen. As you'll recall, we are in an Advent series called The Songs of Christmas. And 3 weeks ago, Pastor Jim preached on the song, O Come, Emmanuel. And then 2 weeks ago, we had the privilege of hearing from a guest speaker, Dr. Wes Parham, about the song, O Holy Night. And then last week, if you were able to come, you experienced a very powerful and poignant production called The Walk to the Manger. And I just want to take a brief moment and give Jeff props, Jeff Martin and his team. So thank you, Jeff. I know that was a lot to pull off, and you all, obviously, every year work countless hours to make that happen. And finally, I want to thank the congregation for your incredibly generous gifts that you brought to the manger, and not only financial gifts that will continue to support this church body, but also primarily gifts that would go toward our local and our international missions partners. So thank you for being a generous church. This morning, we're going to dive deeper into the lyrics of one of the songs that we just sung called What Child Is This? And so I'm going to begin by showing you some of the artwork that many of you have submitted that reminds me of this song. So let's just take a moment and check out some of this artwork. Some of these, of course, were submitted by adults and others of them by children in our congregation. This person's grandma texted me, Bonnie Hayes, and she was so excited to show off her picture. And I wanted to show not just the picture itself, but the artist behind the picture. So, very proud. Praise God for the gifts that he has given us. And thank you for submitting your artwork. And you can still submit artwork for our final song, which will be We Three Kings. It'll be the online service next Sunday. My plan for today is to unpack the spiritual significance behind the song, What Child Is This? But before we do that, I want to also speak to the song's origin. And so my sermon today has three subheadings. The first is the song's origin, the second is the scriptural meaning, and the third is the answer to the question, what child is this? Let's start with the song's origin. The music of this familiar tune comes from a British song called Greensleeves. That originated way back in the 16th century. Originally, it was a secular ballad. It was actually a drinking song, of all things, about a man yearning for his lost love, who was referred to as the Fair Lady Greensleeves. Tradition says that the song might have initially been composed by King Henry VIII for his beloved Anne Boleyn, who became the Queen of England, as she was the second of King Henry's six wives. As an aside, I think it's interesting to note as well that King Henry VIII had a role in the Protestant Reformation because the English king declared that in 1534, he alone, meaning King Henry alone, should be the final authority in matters related to the English church. And as a result, Henry VIII worked to dissolve England's Catholic monasteries as well as acquire their wealth and to place the Bible in the hands of the commoners. So 2 years later, beginning in 1536, every English parish was actually required to have a copy of the Bible. And I want you to just think about that just for a second. That means that before that time, churches didn't have access to a copy of the Bible. I think sometimes we take that for granted. So it was actually the king's daughter, Queen Elizabeth I, who would portray the Church of England as a sort of middle way between Calvinism and Catholicism. So you can tell that the Church of England began to embrace Calvinist Protestantism as a result of King Henry VIII's work. While we're not entirely sure, though, that King Henry VIII actually did write the song Greensleeves, we do know that Queen Elizabeth danced to the tune, and we also know that William Shakespeare referred to it twice in his play, The Merry Wives of Windsor, back in 1602. The first time this secular song, though, was associated with Christmas came in 1642 in a book titled New Christmas Carols, in which it was combined with a poem called The Old Year Now Has Away Fled. But for the past 150 years, this Greensleeves melody has been most widely associated with the Christmas hymn, What Child Is This?, which focuses, of course, on the birth of Jesus. And its words come actually from a longer poem called The Manger Throne that was written by William Chatterton Dix. So who was this man, William Chatterton Dix? I know you all woke up this morning asking yourself that question. Well, I'm glad you asked, because we're going to find out who this man was. He was born in Bristol, England, in 1837, and his middle name was given to him as a tribute to the poet Thomas Chatterton. William's father was a surgeon as well as a writer, and he wanted his son to follow in his footsteps. And while William did not become a surgeon like his father, he did follow in his footsteps in that he grew a love for writing. And so William attended Bristol Grammar School, and then after that he got married and he moved. And he did what all aspiring writers do. He started selling insurance because he couldn't pay the bills. You know, that's what you do as a writer, right? You either marry someone who has a steady source of income, or you sell insurance while you're trying to make it in writing. Regardless, William Dix sold insurance in order to provide for his family, but his greatest love was writing Christian prose and poetry. In fact, he wrote two devotional books, he wrote a children's book, and he also wrote over 40 hymns, including, of course, the Christmas carol, The Manger Throne, in 1865, which would eventually morph into the song, What Child Is This? Interestingly, I think, Dix wrote many of these hymns in the wake of a near-fatal illness that he suffered when he was just 21 years old. He penned the lyrics during a time when he was bedridden and depressed. And this, I believe, is a key point in the backstory behind our hymn. It's no coincidence that the song, What Child Is This?, is set to the key of E minor, which is known as the saddest of all keys. And yet, its words of triumphal joy override this melancholy melody as we proclaim the birth of our Savior and King. In Isaiah 61:3, the prophet is speaking about the year of the Lord's favor, and he assures God's people that God will provide for those who grieve in Zion, bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Friends, this, I believe, is the testimony of thousands and thousands and thousands of Christians all throughout the generations. It's not that we are immune from the trials of this life. It's not that we never get sick or struggle or suffer. It's not that we are exempt from becoming bedridden and depressed. No, it's that even on our deathbed, God provides for us. God provides for us in our grieving. He creates beauty from our ashes. He brings joy in our mourning, giving us a spirit of praise instead of a spirit of despair. So while Dix was near death, he wrote these words to the Christian poem titled The Manger Throne. And then a few years later, an Anglican priest named Henry Ramsden Bramley and an English composer named Sir John Stainer, they joined forces to edit three of these verses of this poem, The Manger Throne. And they paired it with the song Greensleeves, and that's how we get the song, What Child Is This? So now you know more than you ever wanted to know. about the song's origin. Which leads me to my second subheading, which is the scriptural meaning. The song's lyrics start like this in verse 1. It says, "What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet and anthems sweet while shepherds watch are keeping?" And this hymn begins with a relevant question that mirrors its title, and that is the question, what child is this? And we're going to talk more about that later, but what this question does is it leads us back to Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 through 7, which says, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness, for this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." Praise God. From this text, we can assume that the Jews were anticipating the birth of a child, and specifically the birth of a son, who would one day bring justice and peace while governing over an everlasting kingdom as the coming Messiah. But what clues do we have about where this child might come from or how he might enter the world? According to Micah 5:2, we have reason to believe that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. Because Micah 5:2 states, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient of days." Bethlehem, as you might recall, was referred to as the city of David. But actually, the Bible refers to two cities as the city of David, which can be a little bit confusing for us when we read it in the scripture. But what's the deal with that? Why this dual reference? Well, first you'll recall that King David conquered the city of Jerusalem and it became his capital city, but actually he was from the city of Bethlehem. That was his hometown. So that's why both are referred to in that way. In Luke's gospel, however, he is very clear that the Messiah would be born in the city of David known as Bethlehem. For according to Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7, it says this. He says, "In those days a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that in all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be registered to Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn." So why is it so significant that the Messiah would come from the city of David? And the reason is because it would fulfill the Davidic covenant back in 2 Samuel chapter 7 when God promises that a descendant of David would come and claim David's throne and establish a never-ending reign over God's people. So we learn that a child, and specifically a son, would be born in Bethlehem, the city of David, and this child would bring justice and peace to rule over God's people with an everlasting kingdom according to the Davidic covenant. Thus far, we've established where the Messiah will come from, but how will he come? First, he'll be born to a virgin mother. In Isaiah 7:14, we read, "Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." So the Messiah will be born to a virgin. Second, he'll be born in a manger. We've already read that he will be born in a manger because there was no place for him in the inn, but that wasn't the only time in Luke's gospel that he mentioned the manger. He actually mentions it again in chapter 2, verse 12, when the angels boldly proclaim that this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And then a few verses later, in chapter 2, verse 16, he says, so they, meaning the shepherds, went with haste and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in a manger. Speaking of going with haste, this leads us back to the chorus of our hymn, which says this, this is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste, to bring him laud, the babe, the son of Mary. So what is the definition of haste? Haste is excessive speed or urgency of movement or action. Excessive speed or urgency of movement or action. And the best picture of haste that I can think of in the Bible is the parable of the lost son. Because after the younger brother squandered all of his father's inheritance, he returned home defeated, dejected, and humiliated. And then it says in the scripture, while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, felt compassion on him, ran to him, and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to the father, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring with haste the best robe and put it on him, and bring a ring and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead, who is now alive. He was lost, and now he is found. And they began to celebrate. Praise God. So the father welcomed his son with haste, with a great deal of urgent anticipation, by running to him, just like the shepherds did in the story, and just like we should do in our worship of Jesus Christ. We, like the shepherds, are to hasten to worship Christ. But what must we do when we arrive? According to the song, we are to bring him laud. What is laud? Well, it's part of the word applaud, and it means to praise. It's the example that the angels give us in the Christmas story when Luke tells us, and suddenly there was an angel with a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace be among those with whom he is pleased. So the shepherds went with haste, and the angels brought him laud. What about the wise men? We see them show up here in verse 3 of the song, which says, so bring him incense, gold, and myrrh. Come, peasant king, to own him. The king of kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. Raise, raise a song on high. The virgin sings her lullaby. Joy, joy, for Christ is born, the babe, the son of Mary. Regarding the wise men, in Matthew's gospel, informs us that King Herod sent them to Bethlehem to go and search for this child. And after listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, there was a star that they had seen when it rose before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child was with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and they worshiped him. And then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts of gold and of frankincense and of myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed on their own country, to their own country by another way. I'm not going to elaborate on the role of the wise men this week because Pastor Jim will be doing that next week in his online sermon when he covers the song, We Three Kings. So I'd encourage you to take a listen to that next week in your pajamas. But the point is that the shepherds went with haste And the angels brought him laud, and the wise men gave him gifts, and all three of these things are acts of worship. Now, regarding our hymn, I've discussed part of verse 1 and touched on the chorus as well as verse 3, but what about verse 2? What does that say? It says this, it says, "Why lies he in such mean estate where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christians fear, for sinners here the silent word is pleading." It goes on to say, "Nail's spear shall pierce him through. The cross be borne for me and for you. Hail, hail, the word made flesh, the babe, the son of Mary." Very beautiful song, beautiful lyrics. And at the beginning of this verse, again, we see the reference to the manger, which is described here as an animal feeding trough. But in the last section, we are reminded that Jesus is not just a helpless babe anymore, but he is the incarnate word and the atoning sacrifice for our sin. And this leads me to the third and final subheading, which is the answer to the question, what child is this? And as I hear the Christmas story retold and I open the scripture and I read it for myself and I hear about a child, a baby that was born to a teenage virgin mother and a humble carpenter father in an animal food trough in a little town called Bethlehem, I start to ask myself the question, what child is this? I mean, what kind of child would cause a king to freak out, angels to rejoice, shepherds to bow, and magi to bless? And then as I open the pages of Scripture, I find evidence of this child all throughout the Bible, on every page and in every book, from Genesis to Revelation, I start finding the answer to my question, what child is this? Because when I turn to Genesis, I realize that he is present in creation, and he is the ark of our salvation. He is the covenant of grace who redeems the human race. He is the woman's seed in whom from sin and death we are freed. What child is this, I ask? And in Exodus, I learn that he is the consecrated firstborn son and the perfect keeper of commandments 10 through 1. He is the Passover lamb and he is the great I am. What child is this, I ask? And I turn to Leviticus and I learn that he is the tabernacle and the great high priest. He is the scapegoat and the sin offering on the Day of Atonement feast. What child is this, I ask? And in Numbers, I learn that he is our shining star and sovereign scepter. He is the water that quenches our thirst and the one through whom the curse would be reversed. What child is this, I ask? And in Deuteronomy, he is our inheritance and our rock. In Joshua, he is our deliverer and our victory. In Judges, he is our just judge. And in Ruth, he is our kinsman redeemer. Yes. What child is this, I ask? And then I turn to Samuel, and I learn that he is the Lord of hosts. That's right. In Kings, he is our true prophet, priest, and king. In Chronicles, he is the true temple. What child is this, I ask? And then I turn to Ezra, and I learn that he rebuilds and restores. In Nehemiah, he renews and unites. In Esther, he advocates and protects. And in Job, he endures and rewards. What child is this, I ask? And then I turn to the Psalms, and I learn that he shepherds and worships. In Proverbs, he offers wisdom and guidance. In Ecclesiastes, he brings meaning and hope. In Song of Songs, he is the faithful bridegroom. What child is this, I ask? Well, I turn to Isaiah, and I learn that he is the suffering servant, and by his stripes we are healed. He is wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father and Prince of Peace. In Jeremiah, he is our righteous branch and Israel's restorer. In Lamentation, he carries our grief. Yes. Right. What child is this, I ask, and I turn to Ezekiel, and I find that he is our watchman. In Daniel, he is the fourth man protecting us in the fire. Yes. In Hosea, he is the faithful husband who forgives us of our adulterous ways. In Joel, he is the one who pours out his spirit in these last days. What child is this, I ask? And in Amos, I learned that he is justice for the oppressed. Yes, sir. In Obadiah, he is the hope of Israel. In Jonah, he is God's missionary who was buried in the belly of the whale. Yes. In Micah, he is the one who does justice, loves kindness, and walks humbly. What child is this, I ask? And I turn to Nahum, and I realize that he is our strength and our shield. In Habakkuk, he is our prayerful intercessor. In Zephaniah, he is our warrior savior. In Haggai, he is our encourager. In Zechariah, he is Zion's king and coming Messiah. In Malachi, he is the refiner's fire. Y'all better buckle up and catch your breath, because believe it or not, I'm just getting started. Because as I turn from the Old Testament to the New, I keep finding my answer to the question, what child is this? And I learn that he is the holy and righteous one. He is God's only begotten Son. He is the stone that the builders rejected, in whom we are protected, and our faith is perfected. He is the King of the Jews, whose witness is forever faithful and true. Yeah. He is the resurrection and the life and the bridegroom to our wife. Yeah. He is the church's head, heaven's bread, and judge of all those who are living and dead. He is the chief cornerstone who hears creation groan. He is the first and the last who brings hope to generations, future, present, and past. He is the firstborn over creation and the horn of our salvation. He is the good shepherd and the gate for his sheep. He is the great high priest and the Lord whose harvest we will reap. He is the heir of all things, Lord of lords, and King of kings. He is God's holy lamb, Son of David, and Son of man, creator, deliverer, redeemer, and savior, the heavenly man, the Passover lamb. He is the world's light who causes blind men to receive their sight. He is the righteous and living one, for by his blood sin's payment is done. He is the morning star, mediator, Messiah, and master. He's the person that we turn to in times of disaster. He is Earth's sovereign ruler and God's infinite power, and yet he willingly shed his blood for us in his final hour. He is the Lion of Judah and the hope of glory. He is the one in whom that we find our story. He is the great physician and the Word made flesh. He is the last Adam whose lordship we continually profess. He is the life and the truth and the way. He took on our debt, a debt we could never repay. He is the true vine who forgives sins, yours and mine. He is Emmanuel, God with us, who frees all those who have been treated unjust. He is the Amen and the final sacrifice for sin. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. And he is the end. Praise God. I'll tell you who this is. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to bring him Lot, the babe, the son of Mary. Do you know him? Have you bowed your knee and surrendered your life to his lordship? Do not leave this place today until Jesus Christ is your King. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you would continue to minister to our hearts as we repent and confess our sin and bring you gifts and run to you and praise your holy name. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to own the king.
I do want to invite up one of our missionaries that's leaving for the country of Jordan. So, Robert, come on up. This is Robert Kohlberg, one of our former summer staffers. And he good to see you, brother. So, Robert grew up at the Overland Park campus, but he served on summer staff here at SKC. And we are grateful to know him, and we're grateful that he and one of his friends, another colonial student, Camden Twos. Camden happens to go to K-State. Any Wildcats? Just me? Okay. Robert happens to go to the University of Tulsa, and they've come together. They're going to leave for this trip for Jordan. When?
Next week today.
So a week from today, Wow. They're going to head out. And so we want to be in prayer for them and their team. They're going through the EPC World Outreach Missions Team, and we're grateful for that. We also currently in the air, leaving for Macedonia on a mission trip, is Tracy Hootman. So we want to be in prayer for her as well. Anything else that you should let us know about your trip or anything that we can pray for you about?
Yeah, Jordan's currently on level 4 of COVID, whatever that means. So just prayers that the trip would not get canceled because it was already postponed this July. Mm. So just diminishing of numbers over there so that we can still go and minister to the refugees.
Amen.
Amen. So yeah, if you couldn't hear him, he just said that COVID is at a level 4 and they already had to postpone the trip once, praying that that doesn't happen again and you're going to be working with refugees. So, all right, let's go ahead and pray. Pastor Greg, why don't you start us off, and then I'll close.
All right, would you just stretch your hands out toward right now as we lift it up. Father, we just thank you for the heart of missions that you've put in my brother, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that he hears your call. And I pray, Father, that nothing disrupts or interferes with your voice as he takes these steps into the mission field. Father, we pray now that you would bring levels down so that your spirit may rise in this place.
Amen.
And Father, we pray your hand of protection on him in Jesus' name.
God, I want to pray for Robert and Camden, as well as Tracy, who's already on her way to Macedonia. Lord, we do pray for provision and protection. God, we pray that you would infiltrate and penetrate the hearts of the people that they will be ministering to, and also that they would be ministered to themselves as they're learning the culture and learning what exactly you have in store for them there, God. And we do pray that this trip would go as planned and that COVID would not hinder the trip from doing the work of the kingdom of God that you have prepared for them to do in advance. God, we love you, and we give you thanks for Robert and for Camden and for Tracy, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Thank you.
Amen.
If you would please stand for the benediction, and there are prayer teams that will be available for you. If you'd like to receive prayer as you exit today, please stay and do that. And then also, just a reminder, if you came in a little bit late, we do have a New Year's Eve service that we're partnering with Palestine Missionary Baptist Church, and it'll be from 4 to 5 p.m. is a service down at Palestine Missionary Baptist Church. The fellowship time will be right after that from 5 to 6 p.m. If you'd like to carpool for that event, some of us will be meeting here in our parking lot at 3:15 on New Year's Eve. We can go together and carpool down there together. Jim Anderson is going to drive one of the buses, although he didn't know that until just now. So we'll make that arrangement. I'll double your pay. Now, hear the benediction. I pray that you would go from this place telling others about the reason for the season, as you continue to worship and bless and run to the baby Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Go in peace.